So still here at Prismic Studios with Sarah from Algolia, and you know, the first two videos we talked about a lot of topics, how you learned about programming. We talked about CSS, HTML, PHP, how you moved to JavaScript, and then you how did you go into frameworks, how did you learn about these frameworks, all of that. But maybe in this video I want to focus more on a topic that I think you talk often about, is CSS, and you know, the different ways of doing CSS, right? You know, it's an endless topic. You know, there are always new alternatives from just writing CSS, that I don't think a lot of people now are writing just bare CSS. Most people use frameworks, right? And the different frameworks, and then, you know, the new let's say the new ways with Atomic CSS. Can you give us a little bit, you know, background on the discussion, and then, you know, what do you think about it?
Yeah, sure. And I remember when I started working with CSS. So CSS is that language. I don't even think that people call it a language, but it's a declarative way of styling your UI. And so CSS has no established way of, like, you should write CSS that way or this way. It has a set of rules, it works in a certain way, and then you do whatever. And I remember when I started with CSS, like every project, starting to write CSS is quite easy, and then it becomes a nightmare. Like, you can no longer maintain it. You have clashes, you have problems, and that's due to the nature of CSS, which is global and declarative. So you declare a style and then you declare another style, and depending on, like, the specificity or the order of your rule, it's going to behave differently. And that's what I think is really cool about CSS, is the way it's designed. In the fact that it's global makes it extremely powerful, but it's also what makes it quite difficult to work with.
It adds a certain coherence to the design because it's global, but, you know, it becomes hard to reason about if you have, like, too many conflicting things, right?
Yes, and especially if you come from a programming language and you have the idea of scoping in your head and namespaces, that's something that does not come natively in CSS, and CSS is not designed that way. And that's actually what makes it powerful. I don't know if you've seen that website called CSS Zen Garden.
Yeah,
so that's really powerful, because they show you, okay, so here's a page and it has a markup, and then depending on what style sheets that you load, it's going to look wildly different.
Yeah.
And you're like, okay, so CSS is extremely powerful. I don't have to change the syntax, like the DOM is still the same, but then two different style sheets, two ways of writing my CSS is going to change drastically. And for a long time, that has been like the poster child of CSS. Okay, that's how you should write your CSS. And yes, it is powerful, but I think that one of the big problems with this kind of approach is that your CSS becomes really a description of your DOM, and it does not allow you the flexibility to change the DOM without breaking the CSS. If you change your HTML, your CSS is going to break. And yes, it's really powerful when you want to do multiple themes, but I feel like what we build today does not really... We don't really need to have that
different themes.
Yeah, that feature. Like, it may be interesting for you to have a dark mode and light mode, and maybe you want a different, more accessible mode, but that's about it. You do not need to have wildly different layouts. That's something that really belongs to the websites that we had in the past, where, yeah, that's one of the features that you can have. You can change it to your preference. Today, you really craft an experience for your users. You do it with your designers, with your UI and UX designers, and you want to provide that as the unique way of experiencing your design. Also, we're not just creating websites anymore. We are creating web apps. We have highly component-based screens that change, and I think this approach does not scale to that kind of usage. And then, so that was one way. And then I remember in my journey moving to something different that was called object-oriented CSS. And so object-oriented CSS, there is one big framework that used that that philosophy, which is Twitter Bootstrap.
Mm-hmm.
And Twitter Bootstrap, basically what it allowed you to do, so it had some global styles for like links or a paragraph or stuff like that. But then it was all class-based. So it was like, okay, you want to create a card. You have a specific class and you can put it on a div, you can put it on a section, you can put it on an article, and it's going to turn into a card. And it really moved, like it really started to fit that approach of building components. I want to have a button here, I will add that class on it. And I remember that back then there were many new methodologies that started to emerge. Like one of the big ones was called BEM. It's a block element modifier,
mm-hmm.
where basically the idea was that you have a block, so a card, and then a card can have elements. You can have a title, but this is a title that belongs to a card. Because when you only have like those components, like in Bootstrap, you can have a title inside of a card, but that's not necessarily a title that belongs to that card. Mm-hmm. So then you had those blocks with those elements that were namespaced. And so you have card and then card double underscore title. And you knew that it belonged to that card. So when you looked at your HTML, you could instantly see, oh, okay, so I know that this thing belongs to that thing.
Yeah.
And then you have the modifier that allowed you to build variations.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember that this approach was really interesting. It was heavily criticized because of the syntax, like the double underscore, double dash was not really appealing to people. But it was interesting. And then I remember seeing that new trend going to atomic CSS. And so the idea of atomic CSS or utility first CSS is that you're not building components with your CSS. You're building super small classes that have one job. So it's the idea is to really have the single responsibility principle in your CSS. It does not mean that you have classes with only one rule, like a background red. But you could have, for example, a class truncate, and it's going to have several rules, but the role of the class is to truncate a piece of text after a certain size.
Mm-hmm.
And so the idea is that you're no longer creating the styling of your component in your CSS. You're creating a bunch of tools, and then you're composing your components by composing with different small classes directly on your HTML. And so you're leveraging the power of CSS, which is you're going to do compositing of different classes, and it's going to render into a final look using all those different little pieces of CSS. And so that's what I'm actually really advocating for right now, is using that methodology. You have a lot of people using CSS in JS, like scoped CSS or scoped components, which is basically you're going to write your CSS in your components. And it's going, because you have a build step, it's going to prefix it. And so it's going to avoid clashes.
Yeah.
And while I think it's a valid approach, the problem is that it does not really allow you to reuse the rules that you've set. What I really like with Atomic CSS is that instead of building your UI, you're building your design system. And so you're really working with your designer and you're creating a tool set in CSS that is going to match your branding and the rules of your branding. You have three colors in your branding, then you're going to create the class for it. And then you're going to use those classes and you're going to basically use those abstractions and implement them in the way you want to create that final UI.
So if I go back to, like, for instance, SAS and SCSS and all these kind of other frameworks, they were just trying to maybe augment a bit CSS with variable and stuff, but now this is Atomic CSS is a completely new, a different approach, right? You don't work the same way as you work with CSS. It's a different way. You're saying you define a set of tools, helpers, and then you compose these helpers to style your components.
Yes, so SAS, the idea of LESS and SAS was really to augment your CSS with a bit of logic, like you can do functions, you can do loops. And this is definitely a tool that you can use to do Atomic CSS. Atomic CSS is really the way, like the paradigm.
The paradigm, yes. Right.
And it's really like if you've done if you do programming, it's really thinking of it like inheritance versus composition. Like, mm-hmm. you know the problems that inheritance can have that are solved with composition. And like, let's say, okay, so for example, let's say you need to create a component and it needs to have rounded borders. And your designers have decided that rounded borders in your company for your product should be 3 pixels. So either you will have several components that define that rule over and over, and with the product growing and the team growing, you have many chances of that implementation to change. Like you can have one person implementing it one way in a component and another person doing it in another way in a component.
And if you change your decision to not have it 3 pixels but something else, then you have to touch to all these places where you defined
it. Absolutely. And like, let's say if you want to do a comparison with, okay, so let's say you're building an app and you want to have a generic way to add a UUID to an object. Mm. Then either you can create a helper that you're going to import and you're going to add it to your functions, or you're going to repeat it everywhere.
Right.
So I think the first approach is more sound because you have one way that is easier to test, that is done in a way that has been reviewed, and that's it. And that's the idea with utility first, is that, okay, we have rounded corners, we will define it once, and then we use that class and we reuse it everywhere.
So basically you will be saying like, okay, this section will have rounded edges and truncate text, and I would like the text to be in 2 columns and stuff like that. Like
absolutely.
You'll add different, let's say, helpers to be able to style your component.
Absolutely. You're doing the composition of the final element right in your HTML using those tools, those classes that you've defined in your CSS. And I think this is actually much easier to manage in terms of code base, because instead of, like, basically when you're doing components in CSS and in React or Vue, basically you have your definition of your component in your Vue file, and then you have your CSS class that is matching. So you have a card.vue here and a card in a like a card class. And when you want to remove that component for some reason, you have to remember to remove it in two places. While here, what you're really doing is you're defining a CSS API. You have an API, an internal API that you're using to create different products that you want to create. And I think that's more sound, because instead of writing your implementations in your CSS file, which I think should be thought out as a config or definition file, you're really defining tools and then you're using them. And you have a really good effect on that, is that you have less CSS and you write less CSS. You have a CSS file that grows a lot slower, because you don't need to add that many new things.
And to keep adding the same thing again.
Yes, absolutely. And you're really using it and leveraging it and maintaining it in a way, okay, I need to keep my tools clean.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're using them, you're leveraging them in your implementations. And one of the great things is that you have less CSS, so less bytes.
Mm-hmm.
And in your HTML, of course, it grows, but because you have a lot of duplications, then it compresses well. Gzip, Brotli, they're meant to handle all those repetitions. So it works well. At the end of the day, it works much better in terms of performance, and it's a lot easier to manage for a large team of developers.
But doesn't it look like, then when you look at the files in HTML, doesn't it look like a bit scary when you see like, so often if you look at the DOM, you see like one element, and then in the class it's a lot of classes. Maybe this scares people away from it.
Yeah, that's usually what people are afraid of, is that, okay, I'm going to open my file and it's going to be filled with stuff. But so there are two ways of looking at it. The first thing is that I I really feel that you can get used to pretty much anything anyway. And there are a lot of weird syntax in programming that we've become acquainted with. Like, I mean, when you do Java, you have also those long, 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 long names that, like, people writing Java, just, okay, that's the way it looks like. And it's also, yeah, just a matter of habit. And then one of the great things about utility first is the first part, is that, yeah, you start with utilities. And at some point, if you see that you have that abstraction that comes again and again and again, you're going to create a component out of those things. So instead of redeclaring every single time the same thing,
you say, okay, all of these, they make sense together. Let's make them one thing.
Yes. And I feel like,
so it evolves well, right? It evolves well as well. It gives you the opportunity to say, okay, this is coming too often.
Yes.
Let's make them one thing and then we refactor it. So it's refactoring friendly.
Yes, also. But I feel like at the end of the day, especially because now we work with component-based frameworks like Vue or React, if you have a card, then you're going to have a card component. And you're going to put all those classes here. And then you're just going to reuse your components everywhere. So you're not going to see the classes. You will see them once if you edit that card component.
Mm.
But then in your code, every time you want to use a card, you're going to call your component and you're not going to see
any actual definition.
Absolutely.
Right.
So I feel that, yes, you can definitely build your abstraction in CSS if you want and if it makes sense. I think it makes sense if you're editing HTML directly. But if you're using something like Vue or React, it's probably not even necessary. And you're really leveraging that the beauty of having only a tool set that you can also clean up, because there are some utilities that you will not use at the end of the day. You want to have a large panel of choice.
And I can imagine, because commenting on that, I can imagine tools evolving around that, where it tells you, like, look, these styles, you're not using them, you can clean them. And, you know, it's also maybe tooling friendly, this approach.
Yes, and you have tools right now that are doing that. Like, there is a tool called Purge CSS, which is basically, so you're going to use it with Post CSS, which is a tool that will allow you to run some logic on your CSS after a compilation. And so basically what it does is that you say, okay, the place where I'm going to use my CSS is here, in those pages. So you're going to say, yeah, in page ABC, you have CSS. And here's all my definitions of CSS, they are here. And so you're going to ask Purge CSS to look at your files, find all the occurrences of the classes, and then do a diff with your configuration file. And it's going to remove all the things that you didn't use. So at dev time, you have everything. You have all the tools. And then at runtime, everything that is not used, it goes away. And so, for example, at Algolia, we use that. In the documentation website, we use utility first CSS with Tailwind.
Mm-hmm.
And I think all the utilities when we're developing, it's probably close to a megabyte of CSS.
Mm-hmm.
But then when it goes to production, so when the build step happens, it shrinks down to less than 10K of CSS.
Nice.
Which is really nice.
Right.
Because, and it hasn't grown, like, for several months, it hasn't grown. And still, we're implementing new pages with totally different looks. Like, they look totally different. But because they're reusing the same rules and the same design principles, the same colors, we do not need to add new classes. We can reuse what we have, because this is atomic enough so that we can compose on the pages.
Cool. That's really great. Thank you very much for explaining this to us.
Thank you.